some people started wanting personal orders for Thanksgiving or for a birthday. So I started making these sweet potato pies. Oh man. I think that might be my favorite thing to make.
Language right there. Now, see, I might eat a whole one of them right there. You make me a sweet potato pie or something like that, man.
I make the mini ones, and then I also make the regular size slices. Or I also make.
I don't need nothing mini. I need the whole pie. I might need like two of them.
Yeah,
I need many of them, not a mini one. You know what I mean?
I know that I'm beneficial. I can't show no feelings. Been in windows tinted. Nowadays ain't no time for me to kick it. Business to a tinsel. They gon' say that I've been acting different. I'm beyond their mental. I moved on from slinging drugs and pistols. Can't be thinking simple. Tighten up my circle.
Welcome to Booze and Buzz. My name is Akeem Brown, otherwise known as C.I. Wise. Today we are here to talk with a young cannabispreneur by the name of Nafis Hodges. I will let him introduce himself right now.
What's going on? It's your boy Nafis, aka Feast. And yeah, like you said, I'm a cannabis entrepreneur.
Yeah, what's up, everybody? My name is Akia, and I am a cannabis influencer and enthusiast. Ready for this conversation? Let's get to it.
Let's go.
Let's talk. Okay, young man. First off, let me give you a little backstory on myself. I've been in a relationship with cannabis, Mary Jane, whatever name you want to call it, right, for over 30 years now. I am 46 years old, and I started smoking at about 14, so, you know, that's 32 years in, right? Time my smoking, things were not in the state that they are now. There was no legality to it. So things are a little different now. I always felt the way that it is now, it should have been, and I still think there are some adjustments to be made, but we are moving in the right direction. So from that, I'll give you a little bit more about myself as we go on, but from that, let's move forward. Okay, Mr. Nafis, would you tell us a little bit about yourself and what it is you do and how you came into a relationship with cannabis?
Yes sir. So like you said, my name's Nafis, 28 years old, born and raised in Newark, good old West Ward, Bellsburg section, you know.
Okay, I know some people from those areas.
Oh yeah, the good Hooterville. But I got into cannabis. I don't want to say at a young age. I was a teenager. My brother introduced it to me, basically taking me for a walk. You know, y'all know what the walk is for Thanksgiving. He took me on one of those. He took me on one of those, and from there it was up. So you said 30 years. That's only about 12 years for me, so not that long, but I got enough experience, you feel me?
Yes, you do.
As far as cannabis and what I do with it, I like to take it and put it into anything that you can eat. People like to say, oh, edibles, but I feel like when you say edibles, it kind of like narrows it down to either like a treat or a candy. I put it in cookies. I put it in pound cake. I put it into food. And I don't really call the food that I make edibles. I just call it an infused meal. So I do it all. Anything you could put weed butter in, weed oil, weed tincture in, I'm your guy. I do it all. And I've been doing that since 2012. And that was just a hobby.
Okay, explain a little bit of the process to that without giving away your secrets, but, you know, explain how did you even start experimenting with infusing your foods with the oil? Like, some of my listeners may not even understand how that goes down.
Got you. Yeah. So starting off, I didn't use oil or butter. And I was new to the game. I was just like trying it out. Like, all right, let me experiment. Let me see if this will work. So I just started throwing the actual bud in the batter of whatever I was making, and hoping that the blender just grinded it up perfectly the way they need to.
Yes.
And surprisingly, that does work. But you had some people who would be like, "Oh, it was a stem in my brownie."
It's a gritty texture to the brownie, right?
Right, exactly. And so it started from there. And moving up, I didn't stay in school. School wasn't for me. So I took technically 2 years off. And in that time, I guess I started to perfect my craft somewhat, because I had a lot of free time. So I was also living at my mom's house, which was probably not a good idea. I had to try to hide it from her all the time. And I'll touch more on that later. But the process started to
explain how you got that off without the smell.
Right. But that's when the process started to change for me. I stopped throwing it into the batter. I started to do it on the stove, to make the butter on the stove. And that started to make the whole house smell. So I ended up having to go to my cousin's house in order to make everything I needed to make. And my mom, she thought she knew what I was doing, but I was always like throwing her scent off. Like, I don't know what you're talking about. You probably just smell outside. You don't know what weed smell like, mom. Chill out. So, that's how it got to be. Honestly, it became more of a, instead of a hobby, it became more of, oh, I'm trying to make some real money off of this. Even though it wasn't legal, I was still in my bag. Like, no, I'm about to, people like what I'm making. So I'm gonna keep making it and keep doing it until I get caught. That was my whole mindset.
Did you see this as being beneficial to the people you made foods for, or were you solely doing it for a financial profit?
No, so that's the thing I tell people all the time. I actually like to bake. So when I make different treats, it's always fun for me to like try to find a new recipe and try to emulate exactly how it looks. So that became something that I actually love to do. So it was even more so about the money. Yes, of course, everybody
we need money to live. So
money.
Right.
And that's right.
But it was paid off your hobby is what a career is. So
exactly.
There's nothing wrong with nothing you're doing, young man.
Exactly.
Not to cut you off, but it's like just listening to y'all talk about this whole process, it's crazy, because I think about all the time when we're in school, right? They try to force us to apply what they taught us one way. Like, that was just your way. You found, like, you know, that was your craft, that was your thing, like. And you found a way to hone in on that, because like
it's artistry, right?
Yeah, like that's a science for real. Like,
yes, it
baking
is
not an accident. You gotta know what you're doing.
Exactly. Between that and knowing how to follow directions perfectly.
And he took the time to master his craft. Like, he did it on his own at the peril of you know, being caught by his mother or things of that nature. But you know, when it was something he loved to do, and it's nothing wrong with it at all. So
it's like the natural progression, like it's exploration, like that's just what we do as humans. Something interests us, we explore, we're intrigued, like and that's just like an example of that happening. You like, oh snap, because for you to even think to throw some weed and some cookies, like I was trying to figure out how to sneak and smoke. That's what I was trying
to do. Now, would you call yourself a master of your craft, or are you still trying to perfect what you do?
I always find different ways to try to perfect my craft, but I know that I'll never be perfect at anything. I know that nobody's perfect, nothing's perfect. So I know I have that already in my head set. But I do, every time I try to make something, I always challenge myself to either make something that I've never made before, or make something that involves more steps and is more challenging. Like, instead of regular cookies, I may make, like, instead of a regular chocolate chip cookie, the other day I made Oreo stuffed chocolate chip cookies. So I got Oreo stuffed. Right. You feel me? So it's just like, I try to do things that you have
cannabis-infused confections more so than just a little treat, right? These are not Rice Krispie things we're talking about. You mixed up real quick. Like, this is something that you really put your blood, sweat, and tears into.
Exactly. I make Rice Krispie treats too, but I also at the same time make cookies. I make pound cake. My grandmother gave me a recipe for her pound cake. I made that. I make red velvet bars.
Have you done other things like besides food? Because that's what I'm starting to see come up a lot too, like juices and stuff, smoothies. Have you ever tried something like that?
I did, and almost killed myself. and I never tried it again.
What do you mean? The dosage was too high in there?
The way I dosed it, I don't even think the dosage was too high. I think the amount that I drank was too much.
Okay.
And I actually, now I think about it, I think I did probably put too much tincture in it, because I was just eyeballing everything that time. I was just eyeballing everything I did, eyeball. And I went and had the little Dixie cup. It was a Dixie cup full of I guess you could still call it alcohol, but it was I drank it. I ended up in my bathroom in fetal position, spinning in circles because I was losing my mind. And I never tried it again. But I do see a lot of people doing that, and I applaud them, because they be tasting good. Like the pop-up shop we was at, he had the soda.
Mm-hmm.
Yo, the soda was busting.
Yeah, so basically kind of what you're speaking to right now is kind of like, you also learned your boundaries with weed. Like, there's certain things, like, you know, some people might just be smokers and they don't really touch the edible, because what the edible do to them is not something that they like. Like, so I guess that was your exploration again.
Mm-hmm.
Here, you try some, you're like, nah, that's not for me, left it at that. But I know that I can do a treat, or I could do, you know, what I put my infused meals. Like, I know that's cool for me. That's a comfortable limit.
Mm-hmm.
So how about something like chicken or you know, sauces? You do things of that nature?
I've done chicken. The meals I made chicken, broccoli and rice. I made a Rasta pasta, fried chicken, which is a play on words, fried chicken. no sauces. I know someone who makes his own sauce, and man, the way he calls himself a scientist, and that's all he does, is he makes sauce. He makes barbecue sauce. He makes chocolate sauce. Hot sauce. It's a whole any sauce you could think of. He incorporates cannabis with it, and it's crazy. It's great.
That's his thing. Just there in cannabis food, just making infused food. There's like so many lanes to explore, and you focus on what you do best and do that well. Like.
Exactly. Yep. I try.
All right. So, what's the name of your business?
Arranged Edibles.
Monica, say that again for me.
Arranged Edibles. So you know edible arrangements.
Yes.
I'm Arranged Edibles. These edibles are arranged. So
how can someone get in contact with you if trying to secure your services?
I got two Instagram pages. My main profile, which is, you know, just me, but I also promote real heavy on there, because I'm gonna touch on this too. But my main profile is @_BrickGrimes. That's BrickGrimes. And then my business page is @MaryCrocker. So like Betty Crocker. So MaryCrocker.ae. And Mary Crocker comes from my cousin. She called me that maybe the second year of me making edibles. She's like, oh, you Mary Crocker, huh? And it just stuck. I'm like, man, that's definitely
I like
me.
That, though.
So yeah, I like that's how, those are the two ways I could get booked, so to say.
Well, yeah, I gotta get a taste of one of those edibles of yours, or you know.
Yeah, I said I would send some down. I have no problem doing that. No problem at all.
So like, now we kind of talked about you and your business, like how you got to this point, right? Mm-hmm. And then you're at this point in the story that you're telling us, like, okay, I was playing around with this. I got good at it. Now, what kicks in when weed get legal? When weed becomes legalized in New Jersey, what kicked in for you or didn't?
Well, you know, it kicked in. My mom kicked in. My mom was my number one. I'm not gonna say she was my number one hater, but she despised anything that had to do with weed. She did not want me to smoke it. She did not want me to sell it. She didn't want me to make anything using weed. She didn't like the smell of it. None of that. Nothing.
Why do you think she had that mindset?
Because of, well, I had gotten arrested, but I didn't get, it wasn't put on my record. I was able to get it taken off because I was going into the Navy. When I told them I was going to the Navy, they was like, oh, we'll dumb it down so it's not on your record. So it was never on my record, but it happened. And she had to, you know, get me out of that situation. And she wasn't
off. This was because of weed, though.
Yes. 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 And
you know, in today's time, you probably wouldn't even been arrested for what you got arrested for.
Right. Exactly. Probably a ticket, maybe. But once it was being talked about that it was going to be legalized, it hadn't even been legalized yet. It was being talked about that it may possibly be legalized. My mom started to come around and she started to see that I was actually, you know, making money off of it. And I was actually enjoying what I was doing. And I had my own spot at that point. And so she couldn't really, I was a grown man. She couldn't really say much. She just always be like, oh, be careful. Make sure you're not driving around with it. Or da 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 da. You know, our parents are dad.
That's right.
But yeah, that was the number one thing I think that once it was actually legalized, she became my number one supporter. She started saying, hey, listen, whatever you need, I'ma invest in, I'm gonna put money into it, and we're gonna get this thing rolling. And honestly, she, and also once it was legalized, that's when I got into the mindset of actually pushing my business out there for real. So I started, I did a whole rebrand. I changed my logo. I started getting, I got pins made. I got a whole bunch of stickers made. I got new bags. We went Amazon crazy and just bought a whole bunch of stuff that could possibly help with the business. And once it was said that it was legal, yeah, it was up. I was trying to sell wherever I could, wherever someone was saying, hey, vendor, I was on it. Let me come so through.
Could you see yourself one day in a brick and mortar spot making infused meals and foods and things for people?
I've thought about that. I think I've always said that I wanted to have my own spot. But with that, I don't think I want to, like, make anything in front of anyone. I would rather have my spot and then people walk in as if maybe, like, it was a smoke shop almost. But my
you just want to sell finished products. You don't want to have a restaurant.
Exactly. No, right. I don't see myself having like a restaurant. I don't think I'm at that level yet, especially when it comes to cooking, because I'm not all that good at cooking. We don't keep that on the low though. But
you could keep it a bakery though.
Yeah. And I've talked to so many people about different, like, because I have so many ideas, whether it's an actual store that I'm in, or if I had a food truck, or if I collabed with someone and we had our, like, one side had the edibles, another side had maybe hookah or something like that, like a real smoke shop. I've talked to this with so many people, but I haven't gotten to the point of, like, putting it into motion. I definitely want to, though. It's definitely the goal.
Yeah, I get exactly what you mean. Like, it's your expansion plan, it's on your horizon. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of that idea of, like, you might not necessarily want to own the storefront, but you want to be in all the stores. It's like the brands that we go to, like Walmart and Target for, like, you know, right. We don't, I don't know. The only thing I can think of is hair products, because that's what I'm shopping for most of the time. It's
like, yeah, like, right. But you like, know, I'm just thinking about the future and the way things moving, right? And I'm thinking about, you know, because I'm seeing so many THC spots pop up, or vape spots, or smoke spots, right? But we're moving towards like a real cannabis culture where it's really being destigmatized. So, you know, I was just thinking of something brick and mortar, not saying that that's what you had to do. I was just saying, like, could you see yourself being somewhere where, you know,
being local around,
pedestrian walks by and stops at Mary Crocker's. you get me?
Yeah, I feel you.
Get a pound cake.
Yeah, I could. Yeah. That's it. So the way you, when you talk, when you say it out loud, it sounds great. It sounds great. But then I start thinking about everything that may come with it. So it's like, I would, because when you, the way you described it, it's almost as if like someone would be walking by and I have like an open window, people just look inside, like I'm on a beach,
right, you see,
or
the
something
whole...
like that.
Right, you see the whole picture of a perfect America, right?
Right.
Right, walking by, you got the weed aroma, pound cake coming out, nice butter off the truffle strain or something, you know what I mean?
It's a regular stop for the town. Yeah, I get what you're saying.
Yeah. I mean, anything that I could call mine is definitely a.
I like that food truck idea, honestly. Like, right? Thinking about that, because I was like, you know, just thinking about, I like to travel at this point in my life. I like to travel. I like to see different places. And I feel like that's something that if I seen it on Instagram and I seen like the food truck was near me, I would go. Like, oh snap, this is about to be here. Like, you know, if it's an event going on downtown or something like that, or it's an event in Philly happening, like Philly has a food truck festival, I'm like, I've been seeing this on Instagram, I would definitely go if you came to my city. Like, I could see how that would be fun for you as a business owner.
Yeah, now see, and I respect that, because that's the wave of like y'all generation, right? So you hear me talking brick and mortar, that's that old way of thinking sometimes, right? A lot of times y'all want to be mobile and do what y'all doing, like, you know, get it how you live. And I respect that too. Just remember that it's always you being business minded with it. And
mm-hmm.
I definitely think you can touch a bunch of people, man. I seen pictures of what you're doing, and it definitely looks very appetizing.
I try to please the my customers. I'm always asking, hey, what should I make? What are y'all looking for? Or if I made this, who would enjoy this? So like I've gotten people to let me know that they want vegan options. I started making vegan options for different people. Some people started wanting personal orders for Thanksgiving or for a birthday. So I started making these sweet potato pies. Oh man. I think that might be my favorite thing to make.
Now, see, I might eat a whole one of them right
now. Oh man. But yeah, no, I definitely try to, you know, listen to my crowd. Without them, my business is nothing. So I want to make sure that they get in what they want. And
that's right.
Yeah.
And you know what's crazy? You like triggering my business mind right now. Like, just listening to you speak, like, I don't know, ever since I became an entrepreneur, I'm not gonna say ever since, I think it was always in me, but now that this is what I do, I just start seeing everything. And hearing you kind of talk about that aspect of talking to your customers, that's the wave. Like, I feel like that's why cannabis culture is the way that it is. It, like, cannabis is something you gotta, not necessarily say you gotta rock with everybody, but it's a very personal thing. Like, you don't just buy weed from anybody. You don't mm-hmm. just smoke with every, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, in a bad way. It's like,
right.
It's very personal.
It's a relationship. Right. Yeah. And that's why I asked him, when did his relationship begin? Because even in his making his infused products, right? Like,
yeah,
a customer of his will then go on a relationship through that.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Because it's like,
you know Nafis with them good pound cakes.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And, you know, every time a person thinks of something good that they want to eat infused with THC, Nafis comes to mind. So yeah, you definitely want to please your customer, you know. And I think you're definitely going to do that pleasing yourself.
you might take yourself to new heights right here with this right here. Go ask your customer, like, if what do you see for Mary Crocker in the next 5 years? And like, do like a multiple choice question and say, like, you see me in a food truck, a brick and mortar. Like, let your customers kind of feed you, because they might tell you something that's maybe right, a little uncomfortable, but they might tell you something for real.
Yep.
Well, and that's when we really test our limits, right? Is when we take ourselves out of our comfort zone. So it's comfortable for him just to bake what he's doing, but sometimes, let's just say, you know, he get the idea to do something that sounds outlandish to him, but it brings him in 7 figures a year. You don't think that would be worth it?
Exactly. Yeah. And that's the thing. I'm not always looking for people to tell me what I want to hear. I'm always open to
criticism. That's good.
And so, because I've had people tell me all the time, not all the time, but back when I first started out, some people would be like, oh, you know, it didn't do nothing to me, da 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 da. And that, some people would take that and get discouraged and be like, oh, well, maybe I should stop doing it. That actually encouraged me to try to perfect it. I'm like, all right, nah, I'm going to come back next time with something better on the house, right, and you're going
to
feel it.
Right, that became your motivation rather than something for you to stumble upon and never get up again, right? So yeah, now you're motivated to please those who are displeased by something that you love doing.
And right? that's when I feel like that's one of the key indicators, at least for me, that I'm in my lane. Like, I'm in my bag right now, because it's like, even when I hit a roadblock, I don't say, nah, forget it. Like, I'm like, no, why is this here? I want to figure this out. I don't do that with everything. I'm very selective about what I pour my energy into. So I feel like if you're feeling like this about baking, you really would love to do this for free. And you're good at making money with it. Like, that's a combination. Like, that, I feel like that is I'm not gonna say the definition of success, because that changes for everybody, but I'm gonna say that's one of my key indicators you are on the path towards that. Like, because you really love what you do.
That's the best career ever, right? So
yeah,
if you love playing basketball, you try to make it to the NBA. If you love rapping, you try to be the best rap star ever, right? You love baking, right? So you want to be the Rachel Ray of weed arranged edibles, right? So
yeah. Exactly.
That's crazy. Imagine, like, 5 years, we turn on Netflix and it's a documentary, like how Martha and Snoop had their little series up there, a little documentary about your story.
Hey, that is a goal right there, to be on Netflix.
Yeah. So think about what you want that documentary to look like, and just start living that. That's how I feel. You sound like really excited about your business.
I do. I'm always talking about my business to my friends. Some of them, I'm sure they're tired of it, because it's all I talk about. I'm always talking about new recipes I found. I'm always talking about how I want to try something different. I want to try to, like, expand. And it's funny, my friends, started out, huh?
A testament to that love. Once again, though, skip over that, because if you're doing that all the time, that means you love it.
Yeah.
And those that may be around you and get tired of hearing it, then that's when they need to get away from you. But you keep talking about the things you love, man. You're going to catch the ear of the people that you need to catch the ear of.
Even that story where you were talking about your mom, and when it became legal, she started to push you.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I feel like a mom going, maybe that's the feminist side of me, but a mom gonna I want my baby safe. She just hated that you could be in a position where you wasn't safe. And for her to come when it's like, okay, this safe, all right, here go. Like, I feel like she saw your love for it too. And I think that might have been a big part of, like,
yeah,
you
because
said
you gotta that. Realize that when you add the legality to it, you take the danger out of it, right?
So yeah.
Now, you're not worried about your son selling cakes out of a back alley and things of that nature.
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
And even with that, she when it became legal, well, really before it became legal, she was always like, yeah, you know, I'd rather you be here and not somewhere else. She always said that wasn't anything. She'd be like, yeah, I'd rather you be doing whatever you do in the house rather than be on the street doing it. At least I know you're doing it and I'm aware. I may not like it, but I'm aware of it and you're here. So it's fine. I don't have to worry about you possibly being hurt or, God forbid, being killed, anything like that. So yeah, that was definitely one of her main things, my safety.
Yeah.
Especially being a Black man.
Yeah, that part,
which is only right. That's
right.
As my mom did, you know, they're nurturers, so they, you know, in society they was only trying to keep us safe, and unfortunately Black man with some weed up until a few years ago was a very dangerous thing.
Yep it was.
Shout out to Mama Love.
Yeah.
Big Mama Dukes, love her. And it's actually, since you just brought that up, I don't know if y'all familiar with Breaking Bad.
I watched a couple episodes. I hear everybody talk about it.
Yeah, so the show is about meth. I have nothing to do with meth. I'm just gonna put that out there right now. But in a couple scenes in the show was filmed years ago. So a couple scenes in the show, they started talking about weed. And they, you know, the way that they were dragging weed to compare it to like how it is now is just like,
yeah,
the way the world just changed in front of our eyes, like that is just it went from a.
Oh, let's talk about that.
Yeah. It went from the devil's grass to oh, this is just something to help you and make you feel good, and like what?
You get into it. Why it was called the devil's grass and all that, and why they put those stigmas on weed, because of how it challenged the industry or the system here at the time. So whichever way, whether you smoked it, it challenged the tobacco industry, or whether you cultivated it for hemp and textiles, it challenged the cotton industry. So either way, it was bad to America. And this is the only reason why it was named the devil's grass. It has nothing to do with the effects that it had on you, but they had you believe that it was the gateway to every other drug in the world.
Literally, I hated that. Gateway drug.
Yeah.
It's a gateway drug.
And I'm going to be real with you. I feel like anything that anyone does, you have to already have been indifferent to it. You have to already have felt like, I'm on the fence about it. If I encounter it in the right way, it's a chance I may do it. Or if I'm just not feeling, I'm not. You have to already feel that. There are things that I'm very clear that I'm cool. I don't want it. You can never convince me that I want meth. Like those are things you can't convince me of that.
That's right. So even going with their ideology, if one drug is a gateway portal to the next, then our introductions or most people's introductions to drugs is alcohol. But they will never say alcohol is the gateway drug or even tobacco, right?
Right. They won't even say that alcohol is a drug.
Or tobacco. So, you know, most experiment with alcohol or tobacco before they ever experiment with weed.
Yep.
And so if we're talking about gateways, one of those two would be the gateway. But you notice how they skipped over those two, because those two produce money for them economically. And when I say them, I am talking about the federal government.
And what's crazy, I don't know if y'all have the same relationship, but like that was my introduction. I was introduced to alcohol first, then weed. But once I started smoking weed, I really not a big person. Like, I'll drink socially, but I'm not a person that just... No, I actually would prefer weed.
And you are my daughter. So, yes. You didn't fall far from the tree. That is my exact relationship. You know, you taste beer around the house, ale, right? My mother smoked cigarettes, so I tried a cigarette, and, you know, that first nicotine rush actually was not appealing. Like, it's nauseating if anybody has smoked a cigarette for the first time, and you may know that. And when I smoked weed for the first time, it was something magical happened.
Mm-hmm. Yep, I can say the same. Right?
And I never had to go nowhere else, and that became my choice.
It was when weed was weed. It was not when it was za and all these different flavors. It was some purple sour that I had in a purple pouch. Mm. Remember the purple pouches? Oh man. Times were good back then.
And what's crazy is I don't have too long of a time in that zone. Like, I watched the transition, and when I looked up, I was like, oh, I can kind of see why. Like, when I look at other people my age, so I'm 22 now, like, look at other people my age, and I see, like, how they go crazy for that kind of stuff. Like, just because something is called Zai, it automatically needs more money. And then I go and talk to people that's older than me, people who've been in cannabis culture longer than me, and they'll say things to me like, oh, you could get what you call a Zai, but it don't got to be for that price. You could get fire, and it, just because it's $60 don't mean that it's fire. And right. Just because it's $25 don't mean that it's trash kind of thing. Like, and hearing the difference in the culture, I'm like, wow, I could see the division, having been somebody that had a little taste on the one side, and then most of my smoking gonna be this with all these like dispensaries popping up, and like I look at the recreational side of the prices versus the medical side, it's like crazy differences. Like, mm-hmm. This is another age of weed, I'm gonna be honest. When I listen to people talk about it,
like, people are putting more interest into it, so it's more science going into the cultivation of it now. Sometimes you're going to pay a higher price for the way it was going, right? Mm-hmm. And sometimes the person is putting the price on it because of the name, or, you know, you got to look at, on the legal side, a lot of your price come from, you're going to get taxed, and you got, you know, go through so many other hands before it gets to you. You got to pay that price so people can get their cut of it, right? So this is where some of the legality has its negative effects, because unfortunately for some, but very fortunate for me, I am a weed enthusiast. And so there is strains of weed that I can find on the street that are comparable, if not better, to anything that I will ever find in a dispensary.
Mm-hmm. That block work.
Right?
That's ironic. I have yet to go into a dispensary in Jersey yet. I haven't gone to one. The one that was I had the soda at the pop-up, he works at one in I think he said either West Orange or Maplewood. And he told me I should come up there and, like, I guess pitch to them to try to get my edibles in there. I haven't gotten around to that
idea.
From the perspective of somebody, like, I've been to several dispensaries, and I've been to seven different, let's just say, like, stages in business growth of dispensaries. And, like, one thing I can say is that I think dispensaries notice the difference, that people do feel that there is, like, block work still. There are some things out here that the dispensary just not topping. So mm-hmm. I'm noticing that dispensaries are starting to find, like, every dispensary. So, for example, like, Curaleaf, let's just use that. They will sell Curaleaf, but they won't really have any other brand. And I'm starting to notice that dispensaries are starting to now carry a variety of brands. Like, and when they go in there, they tell you, like, oh, we're about to get some cookies in next month. Like,
yeah,
they're mm-hmm. starting.
So that's the cultivator, right? Yeah. So that lets you know the cultivator is coming from the strain, because once I say the name now, that's supposed to be an indication of who's cultivating the bud. These names let us know that this is this cross with this,
mm-hmm.
or this is this cross with this, and it's coming from here, right?
Right.
And that's what that's the good thing about it, right? So even dispensaries It's like potatoes to McDonald's, right? McDonald's has their own potato supplier that only serves McDonald's. Certain dispensaries are going to have cultivators that only serve that dispensary. And this is where things become selective, and this is how you kind of can keep a monopoly on the game, like, right? But disguise it as if it's not really that going on.
I definitely see how there's so many parts that we touch, and especially when we get into a conversation of once it becomes legal, like you think about things about like, okay, well, what exactly are we being taxed for with the weed? You know, that's a whole topic there. Then you like, okay, well, how safe is it as a buyer and a seller to get in that type of situation, whether that be in a business type of safe or a bodily type of safe? Like, as far as me staying out of jail and staying alive, like, that there's so many topics that you explore when you talk about the legalization of weed.
If you talk about the legalization of it, and which they have, and now it's medicinally legal, you have to start opening up questions about, is it medicinally legal to be sold over the counter? Can it be prescribed? Mm-hmm. It's already being prescribed, and it's being prescribed in an amount per month, right? So, you know, a 2 ounce per month maximum dosage, things like that, right? And what then happens is, do we then admit it into institutions to be given out? So, like hospitals, right? If a person wants to be administered cannabis rather than, is that an alternate solution to then, like, Novocaine? And once these avenues get opened up, because you can't make it medicinally okay only for certain, if it's medicinally okay, it has to be medicinally okay, right? These are the things that the average don't think about, but when you think about it on this nature, the young man is cooking with it right now. Do we then start selling weed infused foods in the grocery stores?
Yeah.
Mm. Right? Or do we have grocery stores that may, that like we have holistic stores or organic stores? That's a whole other, those are whole other regulations and things that the government can then put on the culture that we know to be what it is now, right? Something that we've been living. But that's a whole other topic we get.
Yeah. It's crazy because when you think about it, like I think weed is the only thing that I like being a consumer of and like a producer in the culture. Like, I feel like I like smoking weed. I enjoy smoking weed. I enjoy edibles. Like, this makes my life enjoyable. Not in the sense that it's not enjoyable without it, but like how some people like to read books at night, I like to smoke weed. Like, I mean, I just feel like it's a part of my routine, but also it's something that I never would get tired of in the business world with all of the opportunities. Like, I could see myself working and producing and creating for people who are like me.
Explain to the people, if you delve deep into why you like it, because one may not understand, like, it just sounds, you know, to the untrained ear or untrained mind, that would sound like addiction. I like it, right? But
yeah,
if we dig deeper, I can give you some reasons, and maybe you can, you know, add on to those, right? So I like it because it relaxes me. I like it.
For me, I smoked weed and let it go. Like, I kind of was like, okay, I like weed, but I wasn't like a drinker or a smoker. I didn't have a preference. It kind of was like, if it was around. And then I got to a point where I guess that's where the relationship for me started with weed. And once I had that stronger relationship, like I said before, I didn't really care about drinking. But then, like, I really started to notice a difference in myself and in my thinking when I smoke weed. Like, I honestly feel like when I smoke, I'm a more expressive person.
Mm-hmm.
Like, where I'm naturally just to myself. I naturally just stay inside my head. But when I smoke, I can have better quality conversations, not only with other people, but also thinking through stuff. Like, I feel like I'm the most creative when I smoke. So in the sense of, like, right, I'm in marketing, so I do a lot of graphic design. When I smoke is when I come up with some of my best work. So it's like, I naturally, I don't know, it just allows for me to tap into a place that not saying I wouldn't necessarily do it sober, but it's just like an enhanced
that makes great sense. As you know, because you're my daughter, I excelled in academics in school, but to tell the truth, without cannabis, I probably wouldn't have after high school, right?
Yeah.
So it may sound crazy to some, but in high school, smoking weed was my way of self-medicating and bringing that focus that you're talking about. So it helped me organize my thoughts rather than be a scatterbrain.
Yes.
So the focus or the paying attention to detail is what allowed me to excel in my academics, right? So though some may not want to hear this, the truth is, if I smoked and went to class, I focused on what the teacher said so much, I almost couldn't remember verbatim what was said. So it was very easy for me to learn. Yeah. Information, read a chapter and retain the information. If I'm not going to say sober, but if I'm not weed influenced, if I'm not THC influenced, what I've noticed is if I read a chapter of a book, I'm thinking about what the game is going to be like tonight or what it's like at the party, and I don't retain the information of what I read on the chapter. I just was reading words. So, noticing that in myself, I started to realize that this was actually something that was beneficial for me, though everybody said it was to my detriment. Right? And so, only legality was the reason why it was to my detriment. Because I wouldn't be the person that people knew without the cannabis.
Right. Mm-hmm. I think I could like piggyback off of what you said, Akia. I'm not going to say I've always been like a shy person, because I'm not really shy anymore. But growing up, I've always been that shy kid. I used to get bullied in middle school. So before when I was getting bullied, I was just like, all right, I'm just going to stay to myself. And I guess that stuck with me over the years. I'm the type of person I'd rather go do something by myself before trying to figure out plans with a whole group of people that's probably going to fail. I'm a laid back guy. I like to sit in my room by myself, be by myself, and just, you know, be in my own zone. And so if I haven't had weed in a while, and I've noticed this over the years, I've noticed how if I go a while without having weed, it's like I'm almost to the point where I don't want to go out. I don't want to, you know, be bothered with people. I'd rather just...
Yeah, you become reclusive, right?
So, right. And then when I finally get it, it's just like, oh, well, I guess it changes my mood. It helps my mood, actually, I should say. It helps my mood a lot. It gives me energy to want to talk to people and talk their head off until they say stop talking.
Those are the altering qualities of it, right? So it's not negative. And once you understand your relationship with it, it's just you to be responsible with it, right? So we can misuse, abuse, or use anything. When we use something, there's nothing wrong with anything being used. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's like I personally feel like going back to, I like how you said a relationship with weed, because I feel like sometimes people who don't smoke weed, and it's not everybody, it's definitely not everybody, but there is a category of people, to them, it's disgusting. And so it's like, I feel like it's kind of like the idea of like, okay, what's one thing I don't like? Okay, everybody gets on me about it, but I don't like oatmeal. I don't care what anybody says that I had the wrong oatmeal, that like, I just don't want it. No, I don't want you to try to make it for me. I just don't want oatmeal. Like, I don't oatmeal? Like it. Yes. Like, I hate oatmeal. And I feel like, but there's people out there that love it. But when I see people eating oatmeal or buying oatmeal at the grocery store, I don't go out of my way to say, ew, you eating oatmeal. Like, I feel like everybody has their own personal relationship.
Live and let live, right?
Yes.
Yeah, nah. I think that's why I wouldn't say I was upset with my mom, but I was like, kind of like, she was the type to do that. She'd be like, why are you doing that? You shouldn't be doing that. Da, 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 da. This is when I'm grown. And so I'm just like, well, it's not affecting you. I'm not in your house. Like, why are you,
why are you talking down about it? Like, it's not going into your lungs. No, my mom smokes now because of me. She smoked now. Like, he did a whole 360. It's crazy. It's crazy. So crazy.
You helped her. You helped her.
We all went through it, brother. Don't even worry about it. I unfortunately paid a steep price for my relationship with marijuana, you know. But once again, that's another topic we'll discuss later. Anyway, we're going to wrap this up a little bit, right?
Yes, sir. A good combo. So
this was definitely a good combo.
Yeah.
I hope to do a show with you quick. You make sure you get me some of them treats.
Oh, no, I definitely got you. I definitely got you.
Hey, tell the people one more time how to get in contact with you. Do you ship? Do you deliver? Let the people know one more time.
Oh, yeah. Arranged Edibles. That's the brand. _ Brick Grimes. So BRICKGRIMES. It's @ MaryCrocker.AE. Those are the two places you could find me at. I ship. I deliver from Newark to Union to, what is that? What's out there? The Scataway. I deliver. I do private parties. I do pop-ups. Anything or any place I could set a table up is where I'll be at. That's me.
Hopefully we get these delicious treats out to the people.
Oh yeah, definitely. I'm gonna send y'all some pound cake and some cookies.
I like two of my favorite right there. I'm gonna make sure I get some of that sweet potato pie too.
Oh yeah, that's coming up for Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving, I got you.
Right. Nice having you. Hope to have you back soon. You hear me?
Yes, sir. I appreciate it. I definitely be back soon. Okay. Whenever y'all do the video record, I'm there too.
Yeah, bet.
All right, Kia. Let the people know.
So you can find this episode on YouTube and Spotify. You can follow us on Instagram @ Boozer Bud Podcast, as well as Facebook, Boozer Bud Podcast. And if you are interested in becoming a guest, any one of those pages, you can contact any one of those pages to let us know so we can get you on the next episode. Until the next cipher.